Welcome to the world of three-day eventing here at the Fairhill International Three-Day Event, where we'll take you into the three distinct phases of competition. On day one, we have the elegance and precision and obedience of the dressage. These are the key ingredients to look for. From there, we go to the speed and endurance day on day two, where boldness, courage, stamina, and strength are all tested to their fullest. Horses and riders who work together can tackle the formidable challenges ahead. And finally, on day three, the stadium or show jumping, where timing, accuracy, and athleticism are essential for excellence. Competitors who rise up and accomplish these goals will know the thrill and enjoyment of three-day eventing. The rewards are great. Well, we'll be right back with the start of our coverage after these messages. The Fairhill International Three-Day Event will continue. And welcome back to the Fairhill International Three-Day Event. This is Brian O'Connor along with Ralph Hill getting set for the dressage portion of the show. Well, Ralph, we start out with Mike Mendel and Hatton Springs.
And as you can see, we have an Indian summer type morning. It's exceptionally warm for this time of the year, and you can really see the fog. It really won't have any influence today on the dressage horses, but tomorrow it might play a different factor in the speed and endurance.
Now, we've seen in other coverages of three-day events the use of both sand and grass in the dressage arena. Does that make a difference at all?
Well, it does in this arena. As you can see, this arena has a lot of undulation, a lot of up and down to it, and so therefore the footing is a little bit tougher in the corners than sand. So sometimes you can't ride as strong in this type of arena as you can in sand.
As we watch some of the riders go through their movements, remember that the scoring system is as follows. There are three judges that give good marks for each movement. At the end of the test, the marks are all added up, and that's converted to a penalty mark. Now, the object of the competition is to finish the entire 3 days with the lowest of the penalty marks. Now, here's MJ Tunbridge and Bermuda's Pizzazz. They have represented Bermuda internationally. They were at the World Championships, and here they are having a lovely go.
And you can see this movement that she's doing, the counter canter, we call it, on the incorrect lead, around that tight of turn, he was very well balanced. She'll get a very nice mark for that, because that's one of the difficult movements for us on a three-day horse who's fit and ready to run. Very smooth transition down there. She looks like she was nailing a really good test.
Here's Derek DeGrazia and R. Busby from Pebble Beach, California. Derek's come all the way across the country for this competition. He's been winning very consistently on the West Coast, and he's putting in a very elegant and a fantastic ride here.
Now, they test the horse out going both ways. What you're seeing there is a half pass right, and then he'll do a mirror image of it later on in the test. You can see why he's been very successful. This horse has a lot of hock action. Look at him from behind. A lot of action. He's very steady. This is looking like a very good test.
Derek, of course, one of the many USET riders who has ridden for the United States. Here's another one of those riders, Mike Plum and Adonis. Mike has ridden in 7 Olympic Games. Derek rode at the World Championships, 1986. And here's Mike riding Adonis.
Now, you see, this is a warm blood horse. He's got a little more float, a little more suspension than some of the horses that we've seen. It's a really elegant looking picture here with Mike with his red team coat on. Now see, he'll be judged for the accuracy of that circle that he just did, and now he does the half pass left.
Here's another veteran Olympian, Bruce Davidson and Happy Talk. Bruce, of course, is the current bronze medalist, holding the bronze medal from the World Championships from Stockholm, Sweden in 1990. And he's wrapping up the test, or the latter part of the test, with that canter across the diagonal and down the center line.
And this is one of Bruce's up-and-coming horses that he hopes to, you know, run in the Olympic selection trials next year. Now, he gets penalized a little bit for that movement. Wonderful salute. Sometimes that's the longest 10 minutes of your life in there.
Well, as Bruce leaves the arena, let's look at the scores after day one. And we find that Derek DeGrazia and Ars Busby take the early lead with 44.0. Mike Plum and Adonis in second, Bruce Davidson third, Naomi Pitcairn and Yankee Girl, fourth. Stephen Bradley, Sassy Reason, fifth. And Mike Plum with Executive 2, his second horse, now in sixth with 57.0. Well, don't go away. We still have lots of exciting action. We will be right back with the cross-country action of the Fairhill International 3-day event. And welcome back to the second day, the Speed and Endurance Day of the Fairhill International 3-day event. We have four phases, two phases of roads and tracks, split by a steeplechase, and then the riders come into the vet box. At this point, the horses are checked out for their stamina. Here's one of our international judges, Colonel Paul Weimert, to give you a viewpoint of what happens in the box.
The horse comes in here, his pulse respiration is checked, his overall physical condition is checked out. He's in here for a mandatory time of 10 minutes. Seven minutes before they leave, they're checked again and they're led back and forth where they have to be jogged. We say back and forth from us to see if they're sound. If there's any peculiarities, the horses appear to be unsound, we do not let them continue.
If they're given permission to continue, they go on to the cross country.
Yes, and you'll see the first three fences here will have a nice slope to them, be nice galloping fences to get the horses on their feet before the first big effort.
Here's Michael Tucker, our course designer, at the first complex.
Well, we're on the early part of the cross-country course now, and the cross-country course, you have to remember, is part of a speed and endurance test. Already we've completed two phases of roads and tracks, and also a speed test over the steeplechase course. So by the time that we actually come onto the cross-country, there is already an endurance factor. So my task is trying to design this test is one, to give the horses and riders a fair challenge to get them underway, but also to test that the courage of horse and rider is still able and fit after those earlier speed and endurance tests we've talked of. Well, this combination here is the first real test on the course. The first three fences are very easy, very straightforward, really to get the horse and riders enjoying themselves. You have to remember it's against the clock. Every second counts over a specific time. If they're over that time, then time penalties are incurred. And at the same time, of course, jumping penalties as well. Now, this test here of the two fences is one of speed, accuracy, and balance downhill, and also one of control. The maximum height we can build of the fences is 3'11", 1m20, and this sloping palisade is exactly of that height. Approach downhill, so the riders have to have their horse, what we say, balanced. The horse is controlled and able to take off in a sensible and balanced form. The rider then has to gather himself to aim at this V fence at the bottom. Now, if they go the direct way, they have a risk of running out, which incurs jumping penalties. If they jump in the middle, they save time. So before the competition starts, they have the opportunity to walk the course, identify which is the best places for them to jump, for them and their horse, and then take the challenge. And here's a situation where that challenge comes quite early. If they haven't quite got the control and the horse is still running a little free, as we say, running a little fast, then they may easily run past. On the other hand, it may pay them to go a little wider here, jump a smaller fence, and give a few seconds away before they go onto their course and save the seconds later in the course. So this is the challenge here early on at 4 and 5. Well, essentially, all the fences that we jump on this cross-country phase are fixed. They don't fall down. It's basically you and the horse falling if you hit the fences. But having said that, some of them are not quite as solid as others. And indeed, in this case, we have this brush, which in fact we can take higher than the maximum 1m20 of a solid fence. And this would be the solid part of this fence. Here, the test is really one of courage and really attacking the fence and the course. It's requiring a horse to be really bold, with the rider being really bold too. The distances in here are quite long. So we've given the option of showing what is a really big fence, as you can see, and we're allowed to make it a bit bigger than the 1m20, which gives the enormous impression, I should say, particularly with the big ditch below, which means they then have to really sit down and ride for their life to cross the bit of country on the other side. And we'll have a look at that now. Well, a horse's stride, particularly when he's galloping, can vary anything from 10 to 12 feet. And of course, the rider hopefully can control the length of his stride. He can shorten it or indeed lengthen it. And of course, cross-country riding, when you're riding against the clock, is essentially one where you need to increase stride and really attack it, give it welly, as we would say, perhaps back in England. This distance here is a little longer, so the riders have got to be brave when they jump that first hedge and then sit down and use their legs and their seat, which are their two most important aids, to cross this piece of country just here, a little distance between, to jump a ditch up. Now, it may well be that they'll find themselves a little further off the ditch than they want to be when they take off. So hence, the horse has got to be courageous and help the rider out. But then we've got another problem. So if the rider and horse are in any way disjointed, we have a third chance that they've got to get their act together before they get out of this whole complex. And here again, fun enough, in this fence, I wouldn't be surprised if we find the odd stop where horse and rider have lost their impulsion and are not making the distances required.
Well, thanks, Mike. Now, Ralph, we come out of the woods, we go over the garden fence.
Yes, and this fence I would use it from a rider standpoint of view as a breather fence because we've had two hard complexes. So I'd use it as a breather fence, then that hay rack to get me up on my feet, so then I could make a decision whether to go for the big corner or the long option. If I chose the big corner, then you'd want to really watch this fence 10 because it's very vertical. You could take a hit, and you don't want to do that before this complex, the cabana, with a left bend to the Waterloo rails over a really big drop.
And next is the Elk Chapel crossing, over rails, down through a ditch, up to this 9-foot bounce, and then on to the big Tricana log over the ditch at 14.
And right from there, we go to this wonderful big galloping cordwood cradle. It's a good wide spread. It gets the gas back in the tanks. You're at your halfway point, checking your watch now over this wonderful antry fence.
And then we move on to the next option fence, where Mike Tucker is standing by with a couple of viewpoints.
Well, many of the 27 fences on the cross-country course do have options. Those options are there so that some of the lesser riders do have a chance to get round without taking on the really strong routes. It also, of course, enables the best riders to jump the strongest routes and get ahead on time. And this fence, the Hay Folly, is one fence where the riders not only scratch their head, but they also have a chance to be brave and make good time. The option that creates the shortest route are two corners, where the riders have to be very accurate. If they aim too close where the actual width is least, they take the risk of running out and getting 20 penalties. If they aim too far to the right, the thing gets wide very, very quickly. And of course, they run the risk of diving down in between. And that's not a happy feeling. Having jumped one of these, they then take one stride and jump another. And the same thing happens again. So the ability to keep a very straight line, as well as jumping big fences, is the way that they can save time in this part of the fence. But there are also some four or five options behind us as well. Well, having talked about the shortest route, let's turn our attention to the longest route, which will probably take some 10 or 12 seconds more, some 5 or 6 time penalties. Indeed, they would come literally straight down the middle here and jump this hay bale right in front of us. They then go out and take a big loop and jump another hay bale down another chute over a narrow fence at the end. That's the longest route. Has less risk, but at the same time loses those precious seconds. Well, then the next routes are literally across the rails here. You have the option to do a bounce, that means they jump a rail, jump again straight over another rail without taking a stride, and then take another stride before they do the same again. Risky, again, they've got to be accurate, and the horse very bouncy and jumpy.
And after that big complex, we head right to the straight four with Tidworth, which is good galloping fence, to the Saul table, which is a light to dark question, and from there to the nice big brush setting us up for the water complex.
This complex comes very central to much of the cross-country course, and this year we have a new complex which I think might well create quite a lot of fun and entertainment. There's quite a steep run up to the water jump, which in fact means the horses won't see the water until quite late, about a stride or two before they take off over this quite imposing log. And then the ground falls away very steeply again, straight into the water. Well, the difficulty as far as the riders are concerned is that at a point as they come up the bank, the horses will suddenly see the water and probably hesitate. So the rider has to react accordingly. He has to be in a position to say, go on, mate, it's all right, really, jump it. And that, of course, is where a lot of trust in the horse comes in. So the possibilities are that the rider has to come to this fence perhaps a little faster and a little stronger than he would actually like. He really, if you like, has to throw his heart over the fence. If the horse goes, of course, that's fine. If he doesn't, we may well find the rider's going over in front of the horse.
And we're not quite home yet. We go on to the Huntsman's Hangover, number 24, which takes us to the Helsinki off a tight turn there, 25. And then we go around to the Hunt Cup rails, 26, and the last combination on the course.
And this fence is really designed so that the riders know exactly what energy they have left in their horse, and they can then make their decision of where they go. If they come literally straight through the middle and aim at this very short front, which is just about 4 foot, they take a risk, because the horse has to have a bold approach to land far enough up the bank, not take a stride, and literally jump straight over. Now, if the horse is tired and he's lacking in energy, he can easily run out, and 20 penalties at the second last fence when you're clear before could be absolutely crucial. If you don't take that risk, and it will be probably quite risky, you have then to jump up on an angle, go all the way round, and then jump quite a small fence around on the far side by the red flag. And that will, of course, take 6 or 7 seconds more. But if you jump it clear and have no jumping penalties, just have a few time penalties, that may well be a sensible decision. On the other hand, the best horses and the best riders, the ones that are going to win the Fairhill Championship, will be the ones that take the straight route right the way through. Quite likely, they'll be the ones that represent the United States of America in the Barcelona Olympics next year.
And one more fence to go. Cecil's Produce stand at 28 and on to the finish. Well, Ralph, we've got folks assembled to watch the cross-country action.
And the horses are in the vet box.
And we'll be right back with more coverage of the speed and endurance at Fairhill. Brian O'Connor, along with Ralph Hill, now taking you out on the cross-country course. Here is Jane Sleeper and Out on Business.
Now, she's opting here to take a little bit longer route, but you can see her experience with this horse, because these are seasoned campaigners right here. He got right through it very quickly.
He's up over the big brush, a couple of strides up the bank, and keep pressing forward, out over six, the brush at the top.
Yeah, that was very exciting there, and you could see that Michael Tucker said that it would be a little bit of a long distance coming up, and it was. But look at this horse. I mean, you can tell he's very comfortable with his job, and he's making this job look easy.
We noticed that the fog is really thick this morning. They, in fact, had to delay the start of the cross country by 30 minutes because they couldn't see the fences out there.
Yeah, I know. It gets a little bit, you know, you're not catching the fences until about 50 yards out. So there are a lot of riders I know a little apprehensive early here.
Here's Phyllis Dawson. She was a member of the Olympic team in 1988.
And you can see there, she added the stride real quick there, which a greener horse will do. And here's the Cabana. She's going to run the same angle.
A little deceiving there, but yeah. You don't see the drop there. It's a pretty good drop on the
drop.
Backside of that.
And you can see it had a little more effect on that green horse. Now, Jane's opting to do the 13-foot to the 21-foot to the 13-foot, and it looked like a gymnastics on this old
horse.
That
was easy. Bounce, one stride, bounce. There she comes around to the wharf, and she's going to go the long way here.
Yeah, I'm surprised about that with this being an old campaigner, but maybe because he hasn't run for a while, she's opted here to be safe. She's got a wonderful run.
Really quick through there, so she didn't waste any time at all.
No, and I think you'll see that that'll be one of the faster times through that water going the long way.
She comes up. Ooh, and a nice bounce over that wall, hitting the top and going right out over that narrow element.
And that's only 9 feet in there.
Here's Mike Huber and Pedigree's Hoopo.
Yeah,
this is a new horse for Mike.
Correct. And you're seeing now this horse has only run a three-day event, one over in England. And this is a new rider combination. So you're going to see a little more conservative ride than the last ride we saw with James.
Mike is a veteran. He's a USET veteran. He was at the World Championships last year for the United States. And looking just a little bit rusty here, but I think that's because of a new combination, as you said.
Exactly, and that's what you're seeing here. You're seeing some young horses here that they're trying to get qualified for the Olympics. You're seeing some older ones that they're trying to get a two-star under their belt. I mean, this is serious stuff out here.
Here's Phyllis. She comes to the water complex. Her first rider we see hanging a leg there, but she stayed balanced and was able to keep him down into the water and out over the wharf at the back.
Yeah,
well
she,
done.
She took off half of her Vaseline there at that one.
Here's Melinda Gosselin and Leroy, relative newcomers to the advanced three-day event world, and she handled the Palisades there with no trouble at all.
Yep, she was smart there. She stayed in the back seat, and she grabbed that left rein a little bit when he started to get away. That was a smart ride.
Going to have to push here. Get up on that hill. Oh, he really hung a leg. But still, she was able to keep him together enough to get out over that back brush.
Yeah, that back brush is very forgiving, but remember Michael Tucker said it's going to be a long distance up onto that bank, and it was.
There's Phyllis nicely out over the combination of 27. She only has one more to go.
That horse is still galloping very nicely.
Here's Mike with Pedigree's Hoopoe. They're going to go. Looks as though the bounce one stride bounce.
Yeah, I talked to Mike earlier about this, and he felt that since he doesn't know this horse real well, it would be better, you know, just to get a good, clean, safe round and, you know, next year take the shot.
Well, that's where the experience comes in. He also goes the long way here at the water. He really has to check back, make a very sharp right-hand turn down over the little rail. Ooh, a little hung up there at the corner. And then back over the wharf, water to water, and then out over the backside.
Yeah, you see, if you keep it smooth like Jane does, did that last time, the horse keeps running and concentrating on what you're doing. He was a little bit lost, too much momentum, and it just didn't work out. Granted, he didn't get any penalties, but you could see the horse dropped his leg.
Here's Linda in Operick from Canada.
She's in trouble.
Gonna have to push here.
You can see the horse landed a little weak. Now she's got a dilemma. If she walked the course, she'll know what options she has. If this
gonna
is
have to
ABC.
Push him up. No, he wants no part of that ditch. Unfortunately, when you get hung up in the bottom there, you don't have much room to make any turn to get fired up to get up that hill.
Exactly. She should be looking for places off to the left or whatever where she could angle. No. I mean, there's just no way from this
That's
standstill.
A third refusal there, and three refusals at any one obstacle, unfortunately, is going to pull competitors right out of the competition.
And usually at this point, they're asking her to, you know, please leave the course because you have other riders coming on. I don't know why she's still in here at this point. She's coming again.
She's had three. Well, there's a fourth refusal, and she's definitely going to have to get out of the way because the next rider is going to be right on her tail here in right just a minute.
Exactly. Common courtesy.
Well, we'll be back with more exciting action. Don't go away. Fairhill International three-day event cross-country still to continue. And we're back on the cross-country action here at Fair Hill. Here's Mike Mendel in Hatton Springs coming down to the Palisades at 4 and 5. Oh, and Ralphie has had a run out and the fall there, left-hand side.
Yeah, you could see he got left behind and shaken out of the tack a little bit over the first one. And then he lost his line to the second one, and he was leaning into the jump, and the horse had different ideas. Now, his job now is to get on as quick as he can, grab another option. Don't waste time. You already have 60 penalties. You know, get going.
What's real deceiving about this camera shot is that you don't really get the full depth of that downhill there. That's a pretty sharp incline.
Oh, yeah, and from the horse's perspective, from the top, it looks like he's jumping.
He's going to have to push here. Oh, he's way back in the saddle.
Missed his line again. One of the first things we learned is to try to keep direction. He got ahead of his horse there, jumped way left, and the horse didn't have a chance. And what a game horse to come from that short a distance, because that is a substantial leap.
That's a good recovery there. He's going to pick up 20 additional penalties. Now, here's the first rider through
beautiful.
The double corners. Melinda Gosselin and Leroy very nicely over those two very wide corners. Here she comes to the water. She's going to have to push.
That was going to be the first one so far that we're going to see go through this fast way. And now she probably ought to go. She's already got 20. Her best bet, rather than to get another 40, since it counts double, is to go the long way. But wait a minute. It looks like she's going to try it again.
She's going to come right back after it.
Yep. That's what you're here for, learn.
She's had a second refusal, so she's got to think about going the long way. Now, remember, we did see Phyllis through the short way.
Oh,
earlier.
That's correct. It dropped the leg. That's
and she
correct.
Was good there, but she's all right. But Melinda very wisely opting for the third try to go the long way, because if she has a third stop at this complex, she's out of the competition.
That's correct.
She's down into the water, just regrouping here, and out over the dock.
And she really did make it a long way there, you could see, versus what Jane did.
Here's John Staples and Dragant.
Now, this horse has been around this course last year, but they have had some new changes. You can see this horse is so brave and bold. He had a little trouble with that turn there. But John's very confident. He said he's going to try to make the time. And you can see he just smokes this.
Oh, that is really good through that combination there. John staying very balanced, well forward. He lets the horse go through. Now we come over the cabana and down to the hillside rails. He's going to go over the middle element there. Oh, the horse really hung a leg badly, and down they go.
Oh, man.
They look as though they're winded here. The horse is in a tough situation because he's facing uphill. He's really going to scramble and not really pretty there, but the horse is up, seems to be okay. John's still down there.
Well, I think that, you know, definitely that kind of fall. You think that's about a 6-foot drop. and that's not counting how high you are on top of the horse. That's going to knock the air out of you. But again, John is, you know, in condition. He gets fit for this. His horse is fit. They'll both, as soon as they catch their air, will be fine.
Well, there's John. In fact, he's up, and Ellie trots on over. So they're both okay, and they're going to continue on.
See, and that's his mileage. You know, a greener rider might have laid there a little longer and maybe felt sorry for themselves a little bit. John knows that, you know, hey, he's got 60. He better get rocking and rolling here.
Well, at this point, too, he's got the 60, so he's got to finish the course just to get the horse's confidence back, as you said. But he doesn't have to push for time now. He's going to play smart, go the long way if he has to, but yet he wants to finish the course.
Yes, and exactly. And you can see the horse learned a little bit something
comes.
About dropping his leg. Look at him. He put those legs up after that.
Through the bounce.
Now, John also has to think about is it being an Olympic trial, right? You, if you're trying to qualify for the Olympics, you're allowed less than 80 penalties. So John right now is sitting less than 80. So he's got to just try to get around clean now so that he qualifies this horse this year.
He's got to finish. Now, here's Mike Mendel. He's unfortunately having a bad go on the course today. He's picked up another 20 for the refusal. He's got to go the long way.
Oh,
hanging a leg there.
Yeah, I can't
see the mud on his back.
Yeah,
he's had a fall on the course already.
Now, you can see John Madden would say that that's what the sport's about, you know, mud and blood and stuff like that. But that's the National Football League. Our sport is to keep that jersey as clean as possible.
So Mike's got to be thinking, I just got to finish now. I've got a lot of penalties, but I want to finish. Here's Nancy Lindroth, an aeronaut. She was a member of the 1987 Pan American team. And unfortunately, that downhill gravity really pulled her down there, and she's going to have to go the long way. She picks up 20 penalties for a refusal.
Well, and you can see there was a perfect example of what Michael Tucker was saying, out of control.
Oh, she's got a second one. Horse really getting hung up in the bottom there.
Yep, and you can see she didn't really plan that route. When she ran by that fence, you know, of course, that tends to frustrate us a little bit, and we lose our concentration. That's what happened there.
Push out. There she is. Now, that's a quick 60. I mean, that was less than 30 seconds. She picked up all those penalties. John Staples and Dragon after a fall, really good over the corners.
Yeah, you can see he knows that he just picked up the horse a little bit and the horse lost focus so at that fall. So he's going on and take the shot now.
He's going right straight through the water. What a fantastic ride there.
Oh, that
well
horse was
balanced.
So neat and tidy. And you notice he didn't even rub going in.
That's a big leap when you go all the way down to the water. Here's John up to the bank. And unfortunately, he missed his line there. Just that narrow face. Just really came into play there. John wasn't directly perpendicular to the line there, so he's got to go the long way.
Yes, this course does test out some of your accuracy.
Well, we'll be back with more exciting action right after these messages. Brian O'Connor back with Ralph Hill on the cross country of the Fairhill International 3-day event. Here's Dorothy Trapp and Malachi from Kentucky down through the Palisades. Nicely handled there at 4 and 5.
Yeah, she's having a really good round. Look at here. She pressed him up, left the stride out, did it in one. That's the way it's supposed to be done.
And she's kicking right out over the woods. She's over the cabana down to the downhill rails. Remember, this is where John had a fall earlier. She goes right at the same spot there, and she is clear.
Yeah, notice no interruption, though. She didn't mess with the horse's head, just kept it direct and simple.
Next of our international competitors, Ludi May, Teresa Washtock from Canada.
Yeah, this is a tough mare. I've sat on her before. She really likes to rock and roll, and sometimes, as you can see, sometimes she doesn't want to listen to you.
And she handled that with no trouble at all, right up through the uphill combination. Dorothy Trapp, a huge jump over the corners. That horse really hung his legs up there extra seconds to clear those elements.
Oh, yeah, she's just having a heck of a trip. Oh, look at this.
Look at this go through the water.
Beautiful. Definitely had to be the fastest one so far through there.
She went through there like there was nothing there at all.
Let's see her
shaking the water out of her ears.
She knows, man, I'll tell you.
Here's John Williams and Bailey. Not only is John competing here in the International 3-day Advanced Competition, he also has a horse in the other division trying out for the Pan American squad.
Yeah, this is his horse that he just brought along to back up the horse that he wanted to run in the Pan Ams, and you can see this horse is really rolling.
Dorothy Trapp. He is over. The combination at 27, she has one more to go. She's clear so far. Here's Teresa Washtock, Ludi May to the water.
She'll go down the pike. This girl doesn't like taking long leaps, as you can see.
Well back on the reins.
Yep, she likes to slip the reins and get back on this mare because this mare sometimes just leaves strides out.
Here's Karen McCullum and Inascar on the front of the course. They're going to go the long way.
Just a little weak there and a little head.
She's going to have, she has a trouble, a little bit of a run out there.
You can see no balance there. She got over top of her knee. She was leaning down on the horse's neck. The horse never had an opportunity to get straight. If you're going to take the long way, take the long way. Make sure you're straight coming out. And she didn't do that.
Now, with this being so much fog in the air and the air being damp and the ground being damp, is that going to make a big difference at that kind of downhill combination?
Oh, yeah, it's definitely something to consider, but realize we can adjust. Oh, left
the
leg
there.
We can adjust what type of caulks we want to put in to help
studs for the shoe.
Yeah, stud for the shoe. She's in a dilemma here. She's got to decide whether she wants to continue to play, and then if she does, she only has to jump that brush fence.
She has really no out. She's got to either jump back over the ditch or try to go out over the brush if she can, but...
It looks like she's opting to withdraw.
Yeah, she's going to pull out of the competition. I guess she decided she'll come back another day.
Well, there's a lot of course left.
Here's John Williams and Bailey.
And he's having
over the corners.
You can tell he's taking all the fast options. He's out to make the time, you can tell.
Up over the wharf, over the big log, out over the backside there. A good ride through the water.
Yep, this horse is still running with his ears pricked, as they say.
Here's Mark Combs in Solomon. He's a newcomer to the advanced three-day competition. He's been coming up through the young rider ranks over the last 2 or 3 years, competing very successfully. And here he is now at Fair Hill.
Yeah, and you can see this horse is a little more conservative. He added the stride there. You know, he's a little safer of a horse. You know, he's a little more cautious than the last, like this Bailey horse.
John Williams bouncing up over the combination at 27. He has one more to go.
He's had a wonderful trip. He's got to be very excited.
He's really going clear. As he heads to the last. Here's Jocelyn Cooch, Portobello. She's really going to have to keep him to the left there. She's okay, but right at the very last second there to make the second part of the Palisades.
Yeah, that was interesting she opted that line. That horse must turn left better than he turns right. Wonderful leap there.
There she goes. She's back together there.
She's riding by the seat of her britches there.
Here comes Mark Combs and Solomon. He's going to go for the corners and a big lean back there. A little fist in the air. Come on, Mark. Keep your hands on the reins. You're not done yet.
That's right. You've got to stay focused. This is advanced. You can see the horse is a little more conservative, but he's brave enough to keep trying. Mark, as we found out the time, remember when we watched him at Essex, he tends to like to kick back behind him when he gets in trouble, which is a smart move.
Here's the next of our Canadian riders, Robert Stevenson and Risky Business.
This is a wonderful horse from England, and you can tell this horse has got a lot of gallop. And you can see different people handle the nerves in different ways, and this boy's growling and scrumping.
I tell you, Robert's going to finish this course with his voice, if not with his horse. Here's Jocelyn, a little difficulty here at the bounces. Hang on, Jocelyn. Oh, down she goes.
And that was just, you know, she couldn't keep the horse between her and the ground. He was turning the way she wanted to turn. She just didn't.
Looks like she got hung up in the second part of the bounce there, and looks as though she's all right. She's going to remount here. She picks up the 60. None the worse for wear, I suppose. As she kicks off on now to the next fence.
Yeah, she's young. You know, this is all education, and you know she's got a wonderful jumper. She'll be back another day.
Here's Mark Combs and Solomon. Oh, he's got to push out. He has one more to go. He's got a clear round going so far.
So he's got to be excited. His first advance. You can see him there petting horse on the neck. That's when you should do it, not after those corners.
We'll be right back after these messages with the Fair Hill International 3-Day Event cross-country coverage. And welcome back to the 1991 Fair Hill International 3-Day Event and our cross-country coverage. Ralph Hill along with Brian O'Connor. Well, Ralph, here we have Naomi Pitcairn, Yankee Girl, nicely through the Palisades at 4 and 5.
Yeah, is this a wonderful jumper little mare. She's got lots of experience. Naomi's just learning about advance, and what better way to learn than an experienced campaign.
And she's up through the brush and the banks. And here she heads around to the park gates. We haven't seen anybody jump that yet. Shows you how big that fence is. Remember that these jumps can be up to 3'11" high.
A really nice round through here. This boy's
putting on the trip. A little rough there through the last element. And Robert is still talking. He's talking up a storm as he comes down through the water. He's having a great go so far. He's clear, and his time's good. He could have a clear round here with no time faults.
I know, he really is. He really has the hammer down.
He comes up to the last combination. And there he kicks on. You can hear him. He's really pleased.
He heads on
to the produce stand. He has one more to go. His time is good so far. Over the last and on to the finish.
Well, he's got to be excited about that. That was a wonderful round.
Here's MJ Tunbridge and Bermuda's Pizzazz, and they are down over 4 and 5.
Yeah, this is a good rider combination. They've been together for quite some time. She jumped him around the world championships. I mean, this is a solid team.
Yes.
And we've got a score in for Robert. He finished the course with no faults, no time faults. He's one of just two riders, I believe, to do that on this cross-country course.
Yeah, they got to be excited to go that fast with this many efforts.
Here's Naomi to the water with Yankee Girl. Oh, a little tight in there, but she's okay. Down through the water and over the dock. She was lucky to come out of that with no faults.
Yeah, but there's where the experience of the horses. She stayed out of the mare's way, gave her her head, and the mare sorted it out.
And a good jump over the bounce there. Really. She heads on to the last.
Now, there's another excited first time around in the Vancer.
Now here's our leader, Derek DeGrazia and R. Busby. He's in the lead, 44.0. He's got a lot of pressure on him because he's had a couple riders gone before him with clear rounds and one rider with just a few time faults. So Derek has really got to go with no jumping faults and try to beat the time.
Well, I can assure you from competing with Derek over in Europe, he knows exactly how fast he has to go to maintain the lead. So he'll do the least amount of pressure on his horse, and he'll know exactly how much time he's allowed to have.
MJ, bounce, one stride to the bounce.
Did you see how clever that horse was there, coming through a bending turn through there? That's a good combination.
And she comes up to the water. She's going to have to ride. Oh. Hoo-hoo, she almost tipped over there.
You knew she felt.
She lost the stirrup.
Yeah. You could feel that she could feel coming around that turn that horse wasn't quite there.
Really throwing that shoulder out. He really
wasn't
paying attention.
She went right after him with the stick.
Here's another U.S. rider who's ridden for the U.S. team. Here's Louise Merriman on Great Expectations. She represented the United States in Germany a couple of years ago. Here's our leader, Derek DeGrazia. He is nicely through the bounce, one stride bounce from Pebble Beach, California, hitting a great stride there with R. Busby.
Yeah, it's a good combination. They know each other really well. You know, you can see they're very confident with one another. So right through the water, no problem. It's a good team, good partnership.
This could be a team really shoot out in the forefront for the Olympics next year, huh? Oh, a little tight in there. That's the only trouble we've seen Derek had on the course.
You find out when you cross-country ride, there's usually always one fence that you'd like to go back and
Here's
change.
Louise them. To the corner. She's
in trouble.
Hanging a bad leg there. Looks as though she took a little bit too much out of that second oxer on the back element.
Yeah, she jumped in just a hair weak, and he tried his all. I mean, he tried to twist his body every which way he could and just hooked up with the hind legs. It looks like we're going to be all right here. It was nice to see her go out, trot the horse, make sure he's all right before you go on and put any more pressure.
So it's real difficult about those corners. You have to hit as close to those flags on the left-hand side. If you drift right, those fences get wider and wider as they V out.
And, I mean, they widen very quickly the more you drift right.
So Louise is back up. Horse looks okay. Here she comes to the water.
Now, see, she's jumped three fences before this, and obviously he's jumped those three well for her to run right down the pike here at the water. So we're back on track here. That was just a misfortune.
Here's Jane Sleeper in Carpe Diem. This is Jane's second ride on the course. She comes up over the banks, nicely there at the brush.
Now, you'll see Jane, she had a wonderful round this morning, and that'll carry over on her greener horse here. You know, she was fortunate enough to ride the older horse first, and look at her. I mean, she's just flying now. She knows how the courses ride. She's comfortable with it now. She's been around once. She's going to put in a fast round, you can tell.
Here's Bruce Davidson and Happy Talk. Bruce is currently in third place as he goes out on the course.
It looks like he's got this horse much more under control. When we were competing up in Canada, Checkmate, he had some brake and turning problems with the horse. He's done some bridle changes, and it looks like he's got it sorted out.
Jane Sleeper nicely over the corners. And she opts to go the long way on her second ride. She went this way with the earlier horse today.
Yeah, I'm surprised with that. As brilliant as this horse is jumping, but I guess, hey, you know, if it works once, go to it again. Don't switch it.
Here's Mike Plum and Adonis. He was second after the dressage. He comes down to the Palisades and is clear at 4 and 5. He's probably one of the most experienced riders, I should say, in the world in three-day eventing. He's ridden in 7 Olympic Games, as we mentioned, and he's been around a lot of courses.
Oh, yeah, and you can watch his technique going down to the Palisades. He rode real tidy and tight, even when the horse rubbed him. He never got shaken loose. And then when he came to the big brush fences, you notice he slipped the reins and let the horse go out in front of him.
Here he is over the cabana, down to the downhill rails, and clear there.
And Bruce had a good ride through the Fairhill filing.
And here he comes to the water, and he's going to go the long way.
Yeah, I'm really surprised about that, but you can see he's a little less efficient than Jane. He's taking much more time on the long way than she did.
He had some trouble here about 2 years ago, so I think he's very wisely opted to go the long, safe way. And we've heard that Mike Plum has had a fall at fence 15, has had to retire.
Boy, that's really going to change the standings for DeMar.
There's Bruce as he heads to the last. Well, Ralph, you were right. The leaderboard has changed considerably. Derek DeGrazia, picking up 8 time faults, is still in the lead. But look, Robert Stevenson has moved up from 18th to 2nd with Risky Business with a clear round. Jane Sleeper in 3rd and 4th. Dorothy Trapp in 5th with Malachi. Teresa Wostock and Ludie Mae from Canada now in 6th place. Stay with us. We'll be back with the exciting conclusion, the show jumping of the Fairhill International 3-day event right after this. And welcome back to the final day of competition at the Fairhill International 3-day event. Here's Jane Sleeper and Carpe Diem now in 3rd place as they come in to the show jumping arena. Ralph, apparently her other horse came up unsound this morning and she wasn't able to compete him.
Yeah, they put her in the holding area and then the ground jury decided that he was not physically capable of coming today. So she's very fortunate to have this wonderful young horse to back him up so she can complete this competition.
And she currently has marks of 70.4. Bruce Davidson has gone clear prior to this round. So Jane has one rail in hand. Remember, a dropped rail is worth 5 penalties. So the object is to complete the course within the time with no rails down.
Yeah, she had a little twist there. This is the first riding question. A triple bar downhill, you have to make a decision 4 or 5 steps.
Oh, and that rail went down, so yeah. There's the 5 added. She can't afford any other penalties.
That's a very narrow fence with a very light rail. And so we've seen that come down quite a bit.
And you can see the big crowd assembled here for the final day of the competition. It's a great tribute to Trish Gilbert, the organizer, and her staff for a wonderful job this weekend.
Oh, I mean, it was a fantastically organized competition. We had driving going on at the same time as a 3-day, and it mixed wonderful. And, you know, 2 different schedules, but it was really great. I think the crowd loved it. You see, there he's a little strong, but this is the next riding question, whether you were going to add down that line or subtract from a vertical. Pretty long stride coming out over an oxer. He was cantering a little disunited there, which was dangerous, you know, for going down to the plank jump. Again, this course was a little bit like Radnor as far as a lot of uphill, downhill questions, except these fences are bigger and wider. You see there, towards the end, they made you take a long gallop, roll back on yourself to the final fence, the fan fence. She's got to be happy with that with this horse.
Yeah, just 5 faults added, no time faults, so she hangs on to 3rd place. But here we have Robert Stevenson and Risky Business. As we said earlier, he moved up from 18th to 2nd place. He now has 62.6. He also now has a rail in hand.
Well, I talked to him yesterday, and I'll tell you, he's walking real light. He's like on a cloud. He was very excited with this horse's performance. And, of course, as we all know, you've got one more day. But, you know, whatever happens in the stadium right now, he's, you know, really ecstatic about this horse's performance.
Very surprised to not hear any vocalization. He was so loud on the cross country course yesterday. I think he's really got himself a little nervous and trying to keep himself together. Nicely through the triple.
Yeah, this horse is jumping really well, and I think you're right. He either used up all his voice or, you know, he's so nervous right now he can't speak.
It's a great showing for Canada. They have riders in 2nd and currently in 5th. They've really had a great showing here in the 3-day division.
Right, and you know, he was telling me earlier that his grandfather, who couldn't be here, is part owners of this horse and helped him purchase this horse. So this is an exciting moment. This is a real family operation, so it's wonderful to see him be successful.
He's got one more to go. Big long gallop around the turn, and he's got to shorten back up for that very tight right-hand turn to the last fence.
This fence has been staying up pretty good all day. I think we'll be fine.
Yeah, and there's a nice jumping round there. Another clear round, a double clear, cross country and stadium. Final score, 62.6.
I think right now he's just numb. You can tell it's been a long pressure weekend for him, and he's got to be just ecstatic.
Well, we come down to the final ride now. Here's Derek DeGrazia and R. Busby from California now on the course. Derek has 52.0. He actually has 10.5 points in hand, but you know he wants to jump clear.
Well, yes, you know, this is the horse's first 3-day in a while. And, you know, Derek won a Grand Prix out in California, Grand Prix jumper class with this horse not too long ago. So this is a wonderful jumper. It'll be interesting to see the effects after the speed and endurance. If he can keep his form that he did in the Grand Prix, like you said, he should go clean.
Derek is always one of those very careful riders on the cross-country and show jumping, very precise. He knows where he is at all times.
Oh, that was a shame. The horse just shut down behind a little bit early, caught that rail. Now, Derek's job at this point is don't let that bother you. You still have another whole rail in hand and some time. So I think we'll probably see Derek not take the gamble on the rail. And what he'll do is he'll go a little slower. You know, he'll take time here and protect the horse on these last few jumps.
An interesting side note here, not only is Derek in the lead here from California, but the riders who are in the Pan American Selection Trial Division were 1 and 2, both from California.
Well, and that says something for the organization out there in the West Coast, how they've developed the events and the riders out there. And then having riders like Derek out there certainly doesn't hurt.
Derek has 2 more to go. Now 1 more for the 1991 Fall Championship 3-day event.
See, he opened up a little bit there because he knows he's been trying to ride a careful round, so he wants to minimize, you know, what time he does have.
So 5 faults added, just 0.5 time faults. There is the champion from 1991.
Yeah, I hadn't had an event in a year and a half, so it was fun to come back and give him a good ride, have a nice ride here.
Okay, great. Yeah. Congratulations.
Yeah, thanks. Once again, Mark, have a great.
And a big smile from the winner, Derek DeGrazia, and R. Busby from Pebble Beach, California. It's been a very exciting weekend, and here are the final results for 1991. Derek DeGrazia and R. Busby, the winners. Rob Stevenson and Risky Business from Canada, second. Jane Sleeper, third. Bruce Davidson takes fourth. M.J. Tunbridge from Bermuda, fifth. And Jiffy Reed and Lotus take sixth. Well, on behalf of Ralph Field, we'd like to congratulate everyone here. And Ralph, we wish you and all the other USCT riders the best of luck for 92 and the Olympics.
Well, thank you very much, Brian. This has been a tremendous weekend. Keen competition, fast horses. Looking forward to seeing you in 92.